It's the SNL Hall of Fame Podcast with your host, Jamie Dew. Chief Librarian, Thomas Senna. And featuring Matt Ardill. And now, Curator of the Hall, Jamie Dew.
All right, yes. Thank you so much, Doug DeNant. It is great to be here with you once again inside the SNL Hall of Fame. Before you come inside, please use that mat out front there. You see the one that says SNLHOF? Yeah, that one. It's all brown and fuzzy. Wipe your feet on that before you come inside. Leave your filth outside. It's spring, for God's sake. The grass is wet. The SNL Hall of Fame Podcast is a weekly affair. Each episode, we take a deep dive into the career of a former cast member, host, musical guest, or writer, and add them to the ballot for your consideration. Once the nominees have been announced, we turn to you, the listener, to vote for the most deserving and help determine who will be enshrined for perpetuity inside the hall. And that's how we play the game of the SNL Hall of Fame. It's just that easy. 15 nominees, then we vote. Are you registered to vote yet? Have you registered to vote? Have you voted for the SNL Hall of Fame? If you're just listening to this podcast and you don't vote, what are you doing with yourself? You need to register to vote. Go to snlhof.com, click on the voting tab, and click register to vote. From there, prior to the ballots opening, the elections opening, you will receive an email with your ballot included. And that will happen a day before voting opens. So you don't have to register a whole bunch of times. You're not going to get the ballot as soon as you register. It takes a little bit of time to get that ballot into your hands. You'll have almost a full month to vote. So there's that. There's some tough choices. You're going to have 15 votes. There's going to be some tough choices. My goodness. I don't envy you. It's a tough world out there. And register to vote. That's all I can tell you. Let's go and talk to our friend Matt in his Minutia Minute Corner about Paul Simon and learn a little bit more. Matt, how are you doing, my friend?
Hi, Jamie. How are you doing?
I am, I'm all right. I gotta say, I'm all right. I'm curious what you've got up your sleeve here for Paul Simon.
Paul Simon is an interesting character. I mean, he's, you know, for a little guy, 5'3", who seems very unassuming, he's got an ego that sort of counterbalances that in a lot of ways, and you see that in his history. He's born October 13th, 1941. He is a Rock and Roll Hall of Fame inductee in 1982, and he also won the Gershwin Prize for Popular Music. Now, he was born in New Jersey, in Newark, but he grew up in Queens, New York, graduating from Forest Hills High School. He performed from an early age, prior to using their own names, as 15-year-olds. Paul Simon and Art Garfunkel were the duo Tom and Jerry, performing doo-wop pop songs and trying to peddle them on to Tin Pan Alley publishers along Broadway. So he was a working musician from a very young age. He had one of those ridiculous pompadours and matching suits and everything, which is a very different look from where they eventually went. Now, he is considered the only artist of his generation to have written and own all of his catalog.
Oh.
Yeah, now he's lefty, but he plays a right-handed guitar. Now, early in their career, he was experiencing great success in the UK, and didn't want to come back. They went over there, started performing their New York folky kind of music, and they were big. Columbia Records actually had to force them to return by invoking the language on his and Art Garfunkel's contract, preventing them from going back to live in the UK. Yeah. Now, the song Scarborough Fair Canticle is, as we know it, is actually different from how it was originally released. The song that we hear today does contain anti-war lyrics. That's generally what's played on the radio. But they were removed from the original release and not added back in for several years. Now, prolific as he is, he was almost in one of the greatest supergroups that never was. He and Art Garfunkel were invited to a recording session with Harry Nilsson and John Lennon. Now, Lennon is a very big person, or was a very big personality, and Simon was a very big, or is a very big personality, and they clashed almost immediately. And Lennon, being Lennon, steamrolled Paul's cues, which caused him to storm out of the recording session before anything was recorded. Art apologized, but the project never moved forward.
Can you imagine?
That would have been, like, I love the Traveling Wilburys, but this would have been put the Traveling Wilburys to shame. Like, that cluster of talent would have been incredible. Can you imagine the harmonies that would have been going on there? Because, John with his Beatles harmonies, and, like, you know, Art and Paul with their harmonizing. Oh, it would have been just wonderful. Yeah. Now, he is an admittedly competitive person. And he was regularly compared unfavorably to Bob Dylan, which would infuriate him. It would tick him off to no end. This led to one of the most unexpected beefs in music history between Simon and Dylan, culminating in Paul Simon writing a diss track, a simple dissolatory philippic, or How I Was Robert McNamara'd into submission. So yeah, the folk music scene has some epic beefs that go back a very long time. Now, while competitive, he and Peter Gabriel were very friendly. They both championed many diverse musical acts and were both recognized as big proponents of introducing world music to a broader audience. Paul was briefly married to Carrie Fisher in 1983. They divorced in 84, but continued to date until 1991, which is when they actually finally broke up. Now, Paul and Art Garfunkel's work in The Graduate actually really drove a spike in the sales of their subsequent album, Bookends. They submitted five submissions to the film, The Graduate. Only one was previously not recorded. That was Mrs. Robinson, which was originally Mrs. Roosevelt as a tribute to Eleanor Roosevelt. But Mike Nichols requested the lyrics be changed and then used it as a framing device throughout the film because the music was so incredible. Now, originally set to play Dunbar on Catch-22 before the character was dropped, his ties to comedy are actually quite profound. He's good friends with Lorne Michaels, Steve Martin, and Chevy Chase, whom he has collaborated on with many post-SNL projects, including the video to You Can Call Me Al with Chase, and a more recent video for Proof with both Steve Martin and Chevy Chase. So you could say he has a connection to the show that extends beyond his time appearing on it.
Holy, yeah, wow. Definitely a candidate to consider.
For sure, for sure.
Prolific. Thank you so much, Matt.
My pleasure.
Awesome.
Let's send it down to Thomas.
Yes, thank you so much, Matt and Jamie. I am here today. Going to be talking about Paul Simon with the one and only Matty Price. Matty, how you doing?
I'm so good. It's a pleasure to see you again and talk to you again.
Pleasure to have you back. I know you were recently, your most recent appearance on the SNL Hall of Fame was, I believe, talking about Candace Bergen.
Yep.
Yes. So we have some business to talk about before we get to Paul Simon. That's
all right.
That's Candy Bergen. So she, so Candy received 15.2% of the vote her first time on the ballot. Are you surprised by this?
Wow.
Mm-hmm.
That seems high.
Seems high. Okay. I thought were going to go the other way. All right.
No, yeah, tell me about it. I'm delighted that she did that well. I think we talked about it in the show.
And I said 15, and I said 1-5, not 5-0.
Yeah, yeah. No, no, okay. I get it. I'm just saying, like, even 15% for, there were 20 different possibles. That's, to me, that's a great number. Like, we talked about it on the previous show. She's not a slam dunk by any means. Like, mm-hmm. So the fact that she did garner some votes, I'm delighted. Yeah. Very pleased.
Yeah, I was delighted too. I think, I don't know, it seems like a lot of our audience might skew young, but then the Lonely Island's not in, so I don't know if it skews young. I don't know. But our voting base, we don't do demographics in our voting base, but nevertheless, I was pretty happy with 15.2% as well. Yeah. So maybe we'll see Candice Bergen in the future.
She'll slowly rise.
She'll slowly rise, yes.
Yeah.
We'll have to put her in the drawer to prove or something and then see her rise, and maybe she'll be ready to make the SNL.
God, I hope it doesn't take some sort of in memoriam.
Oh my gosh. I know. Don't knock on wood. No, no. We want to send her plaque and have her enjoy her induction.
That's right.
Yes. So we're going to be talking today about somebody who is about the same time period as Candice Bergen. A lot of people who have watched the first few seasons of SNL, even people who watched the most recent seasons. But the person we're talking about today is very much synonymous with the first few seasons of SNL. Of course, that's Mr. Paul Simon. And we're going to say up top right away, and Maddie and I kind of behind the scenes have talked about, like, technically how many times has Paul Simon been a musical guest? We're talking about how many times he was billed. We don't quite, it's kind of hard to keep track of that stuff. So we're saying right away that we're going to play fast and loose with the musical guest criteria for this episode. We're not going to be talking about all the times that Paul Simon was billed as musical guest on SNL. We're going to be covering his entire, I guess, career spanning
pretty much
SNL.
All of the appearances.
All of his appearances, yeah, because as we'll see, when he appeared as a host, he still performed. Paul Simon's on your television show, he's going to perform music. So we are going to play a little fast and loose with the criteria here. As far as I see, he's performed music on 15 different episodes. It might be more. I don't know. That's unofficial, but it's around 15 times that he's performed music on SNL, not necessarily as the billed musical guest. So,
I know which one is not listed on your list, but which we can talk about as well, which is the 40th anniversary show.
Yeah. Yeah. So a lot of times, when I send out these lists to the guests as far as what episodes somebody's been on. So I think a blind spot that I have is the anniversary shows, but you're right. Paul Simon, very much held in high regard by Lorne. They're basically best friends.
Are they best friends? They feel like they're best friends. Pretty close.
Yeah, pretty close. I think Lorne maybe cites him. It's one of the Pauls. Well, which Paul? One of the Pauls is going to be here tonight. So so I think it's Paul Simon that's basically Lorne's best friends. So I want to start, Maddie, with just kind of by asking you, what's your relationship as a music fan with Paul Simon and his work?
Probably, okay, to set the stage for this a little bit, my parents are not what you would call popular music fans, although my mother was more than my dad. But both of them really primarily like Broadway stuff. And growing up as a little kid, I mostly listened to Broadway cast albums and sort of classical music, and then I would listen to the radio. The exception was that my mother had collected a lot of the Beatles albums. I heard a lot of those, but she had not, for whatever reason, collected any Simon and Garfunkel. I didn't really hear it growing up. However, when I was 10, they did the concert in Central Park, and my parents bought that double album, as I think a lot of people did, to kind of catch up, because certainly in terms of Simon and Garfunkel and also a lot of Paul Simon stuff from the 70s, that concert in Central Park functions as a kind of a greatest of greatest hits compilation. There's not a dud in it. It also at the time was remarkable as the, I believe it held the record for the largest audience at a concert that had ever occurred. There were a half a million people.
Oh my gosh.
It has since been eclipsed. Like, I'm pretty sure Live Aid, for sure, put like a million people in front of someone, but like, or close to it. But, you know,
I think somebody in Brazil, artist like played on a beach in Brazil or something in front of 800,000, but half a million people in Central Park.
A half a million people in Central Park, as to my knowledge, not one incident of a major crime or anything during that gathering in 1981 in New York City. Like, it's a kind of amazing thing. And the album, I very distinctly remember when you folded it out, it was a double album. The foldout was just a picture of the crowd that went across both panels of the album cover and was like, you just sort of couldn't take it in that like this many people were doing something. And so that's when I kind of fell in love with it. And so a lot of my experience of Paul Simon was that I sort of, or certainly early on, I sort of mixed up what he did with Simon and Garfunkel versus what he did on his own. I also very distinctly remember hearing 50 Ways to Leave Your Lover on the radio, driving around in the car in the 70s. I feel like I had heard that song a bunch of times. So that was kind of my entry to it. And then obviously the deeper you go and like the more you hear, the more you go, wow, this is astoundingly musical and wonderful and great. And like, I'm a huge fan. And then I remember being in high school when Graceland came out and just falling very hard for Graceland. And in fact, interestingly, like a lot of the middle shows in his run were shows that I had definitely seen live. I had definitely seen the show where he sort of opens the show with You Can Call Me Al, and like where the band is like on stage, and that's like the cold open of the show. Like I watched that show for sure. That was the first or second season of SNL that I was watching every week. I watched the Billy Crystal season every week, and then transitioned into that first season when Lorne came back and watched all, even though that's considered like a bit of a down period in the show's history, it was certainly my entree into watching it all the time when I was like 14 years old. I fell hard for Graceland and then have been just a huge fan ever since. And I'm trying really hard through the course of this show not to let my own just personal bias towards loving Paul Simon.
You should.
We're
here to celebrate. Like
absolutely. And this was, believe me, you know, there are worse ways to spend a weekend than watching, you know, 20 Paul Simon performances. But I don't want to let that cloud the fact that I think he belongs in the hall.
Sure.
Like I hopefully by the end of this show, I will have made the point that regardless of where you land on the scale, and like, I certainly would be surprised to hear that somebody doesn't like him, but like, maybe there are people who don't like him as much as I do, whatever. But like, you know, I feel like the goal for me is to try to get enough sort of like reasons why, you know, even if you're not a big fan of his, this is an undeniable contributor to the show, to its success, to kind of its mythology, everything, right? So
yeah, exactly. So we know you're a big fan, but you want to remain objective about it, and we're gonna state the facts and not go too overboard. We're not gonna we're just gonna state the facts.
And I'm gonna gush no matter what I do.
Well, yeah, I'm gonna gush too. I'm a big Paul Simon fan, more so his early stuff, and even more so, I'm a Simon and Garfunkel fan. So my dad used to listen to a lot of oldies in the car. So every now and then I would hear a Simon and Garfunkel come on the oldie station. But when I started really coming into my own musically, those Simon and Garfunkel harmonies started really standing out to me, like big time. It almost formed how I love, like kind of the things that I look for in music that I'm really drawn to, and those harmonies between them are huge. That's a big reason why, like, for example, I'm a big Radiohead fan, and a lot of the harmonies with Radiohead is stuff that sticks out to me too. So I'm a big time Simon and Garfunkel fan. A lot of early Paul Simon stuff up until Graceland, probably. Definitely respect him though, and I think a lot of SNL viewers and fans and SNL Hall of Fame voters should respect him as well. So let's get into it. His time at SNL. I want to start actually with the first episode or two, and then we can probably jump around there. But I think it's a good baseline to talk about at least those first two episodes that he was a part of. So his first appearance was as a host. So this is going to be one of the themes of this podcast. His first appearance was as a host. It was season one, episode two. That was October 18th, 1975. And I've seen this dubbed as especially on One SNL a Day, which is a blog that I use for a lot of my research. They're wonderful. Yeah. Stooge and those people at One SNL a Day are wonderful at cataloging SNL's history. And so I've seen Stooge on One SNL a Day refer to this as SNL the concert, this episode. So he opened the show with a performance of Still Crazy After All These Years.
I met my old lover on the street last night. She seemed so glad to see me. I just smiled. And we talked about some old times. And we drank ourselves some beers. Still crazy after all.
He did another song in the monologue slot. He did songs with Jesse Dixon singers, one before he introduced Randy Newman. These were good, but probably not the lead of the episode, for me anyway, I would say. So, Maddie, what are your overall thoughts? What do you think of SNL, the concert?
Yeah, and I mean, yeah, the way I would describe it is, it's the Paul Simon show that just happens to be on the set of Saturday Night Live and has very little to do with it other than having a Weekend Update in it. I don't know the sort of oral history of show two, so I can only guess. But here is my best guess. I feel like they got this unbelievable late night slot. Somehow a bunch of hippies and kids and misfits somehow had talked NBC into giving them this very prime spot on the dial, and kind of, you know, the lunatics were running the asylum. And I just feel like everybody involved in that show must have been like that thing about the dog that finally catches the car. Like, oh my God, now what do I do? And so I don't know whether it was on purpose or what, but I just feel like they did one show. That very first episode of SNL is rough.
Yeah. No, it's an experiment.
It's rough. They don't know what the show will be yet.
No.
And whatever. And I think my guess is that Lorne called Paul Simon because they were friends and said, can you take week two so we can recover and figure out what the fuck is going on?
That's not a bad theory, honestly.
That is my theory.
Yeah.
That they were like, we need a week off right away. To like, we had a whole summer to write this first show. We really don't know what worked and what didn't. We really need to like take an extra week so we don't implode. Like, they had no way of knowing how to make that show happen every week.
Yeah, they didn't have a framework. Like, now we know
no blueprint.
Monday.
Right.
Yeah, Monday they have
right.
meet pitch, and then Tuesday it's table read right. or whatever. Like, there's a
they
formula.
Dress
to
on
it.
Friday.
Yeah,
and they, yeah,
yes.
yeah, yeah.
There was no formula back then. It was just all an
right.
experiment.
So that's my theory, is that he leaned on his friend and said, bring as many people with you as you want. We will do this however you want. We have here's the facility. We have the technical team in place. We have a director and lighting and whatever. We can give you a concert show. We'll put ourselves in a couple of spots strategically. Like, we can do Weekend Update. We'll put everybody in the B's and have them come back next week. Like, just to remind everybody that they exist. And like, that's really the sum total of the Not Ready for Primetime players' involvement in the show. And it's a phenomenal show if you like Paul Simon and all the people he brought with him, but like, it's not really an episode of SNL. And I just think that's probably why they wanted to do it that way. I don't think they knew whether it was going to be a comedy heavy show or a music heavy show. I think they knew what they wanted it to be, but like, whether you could do that every week, could you make a show with original written comedy every single week?
I think they knew that they wanted some sketches every week. The original plan was actually to rotate host. So it was going to be like Lily Tomlin, Richard Pryor, Steve Martin, and George Carlin. They were going to rotate those hosts. Dick Ebersol was pushing for that originally, and that just didn't pan out. So I think they wanted to incorporate comedy. They knew that in every episode, but they didn't. I don't think they quite knew the balance, or if they were going to do, if it was going to be a straight. They wanted to veer away from the typical variety show around that time in terms of tone, but maybe, you know, this second episode fell more into the typical variety show in terms of content, and it might have been an accident. I think you probably hit it right, close to right on the money as far as why maybe they are just like, oh, we need a week to like catch our breath and come back to the episode three with some new material or some fresh ideas or whatever. So yeah, again, if you like sketches, if you're a fan of sketches, this is not the SNL episode for you.
No.
If you like Paul Simon, this is the SNL episode for you.
It also sets a very interesting blueprint for Paul Simon, which is that he rarely, if ever, does the show to promote himself directly. No matter when he, and we'll talk about this more, but you know, he brings on Phoebe Snow, he brings on Randy Newman, he brings on all of these co-performers. He brings Art Garfunkel back for the first time in 6 years to sit and do some two-part harmony together. And even though they have reunited many times, this was the first time, and I think it was, it had to have been unbelievably special to see that happening live for people that had basically given up on ever seeing them together, right?
Yeah, in this first episode.
Yeah,
right here. Yeah, what a special time. And they had known each other since elementary school, started writing and performing music together at a very young age in the 50s. Yeah. And then, you know, in 1970, they released the album Bridge Over Troubled Water. That was their final album. And then they split up. So do you know much about why they split up? Can you kind of give us some background?
Nobody knows 100%. But I do think that the consensus story is that they simply couldn't get along well after all that time. People aren't meant to, you know, even marriages break up. Like, not everybody meets the person in high school that they're going to spend the rest of their life with. I think there was, so at the time that, what I know in the background is that at the time that he came back and sort of reunited on the show, they were actually working on putting an album together and kind of actually reuniting. They had written one song, which they actually, I think, perform on the show.
Yeah, they did.
They'd co-written this one song. I would say it is a bottom tier song for them and for him in the 70s. It's not a great song, but they had written this one song together to try to get it going. That song appears ultimately on both Paul Simon and Art Garfunkel's separate solo albums from that year. They both released it. But I just think the assumption is that some of the tension was around Garfunkel not really being able to write and kind of feeling left out of the process, and Paul Simon wanting to go in a bunch of different directions musically and feeling a little, I guess, you know, held in by Garfunkel needing to be an equal partner in every song, which meant that the songs all had to kind of follow a certain type of songwriting, because you can't just put a voice like Art Garfunkel into any kind of music. He's got a very specifically pure kind of voice that is, you know, remarkable, but is also to some degree suited to certain kinds of recordings and not others, right? And you know, when you want to start to do disco or jazz or bring blues into it or a few other things, you know, Paul Simon has gone to all of a bunch of different genres and really successfully, and is really, you know, I think part of my point about him being maybe like a very necessary person to add to the Hall of Fame is really just how elastic he is musically and how he was able to bring so many different genres of performance to his appearances on this show and to his own career that I think it really is kind of remarkable.
A couple of things that I read alluded to maybe Paul viewing, from his point of view, the audience may have thought that Art Garfunkel was the star of the duo. So Paul, maybe a little jealousy, or I don't know if I think ultimately Paul felt like he could do well on his own, and he ended up proving himself right in that regard. He did very well on his own. So that song that you were talking about earlier, I found it an interesting kind of olive branch from Paul Simon, because he wrote that with Art in mind. So he wrote that to present to Art, to put on, Art's album.
Well, I think they're technically credited as having co-written it.
Yeah, yeah.
So because they both recorded it, as far as I know.
Yeah, they both recorded it. I think Paul started writing it, and as he was writing it, he had Art in mind, and so he proposed. So they weren't, like, they didn't hate each other. There wasn't, like, boiling bad blood there. I just think that they couldn't work together as a duo at a certain point. But I thought that was an interesting olive branch, and that song is called My Little Town, which they did perform on this first episode that Paul Simon was on SNL. And yeah, this was the lead to me, is of course the Simon and Garfunkel reunion. They hadn't performed together, appeared in public performing together in 5 or 6 years before this. So it was a cool intro, I think, to their performances. They had pictures of Paul and Art from when they were in grade school up and through their friendship. Mrs. Robinson was playing in the background. There's a lot of buildup to indicate that this was a big deal at the time. So as a Simon and Garfunkel fan, I just loved these performances. I absolutely loved them. So their first song was The Boxer.
Laying low, seeking out the poorer quarters where the ragged people go, looking for the places only they would know. La-la-la.
I think it was a fantastic performance. And I know Paul performed The Boxer again on SNL. This one was fantastic with Garfunkel.
In a 45-year 18 appearance run, he's performed the same song twice.
Right.
Which is pretty amazing. So The Boxer is one of the two songs that he's performed more than once.
Yeah. What do you think of these Simon and Garfunkel performances here? Like, I might be biased, but I thought they were great.
They're great. No, it's like they're, I mean, from that perspective, you know, they're both, it's interesting as you, like with anyone, as you kind of follow their career and they get much older, you know, you start to hear it in their voice. They can't quite hit the notes the same way. But at this point, they're both right in the pocket.
As far as their performance too, Scarborough Fair is one of my favorite songs from that era. It's one of my favorite Simon and Garfunkel songs. To me, I know they say comparison is the thief of joy, but their performance here of Scarborough Fair might be the highlight of the three songs that they perform.
Oh, that's so interesting.
That's such a haunting song to me.
I can see that.
Are you going to Scarborough Fair? Parsley, sage, rosemary, and was a true love of mine.
I mean, the highlight for me in that episode, only because I think of their performances as always being close to perfect, the actual highlight for me is hearing Paul sing the Randy Newman song before he introduces Randy Newman, because his version of, because for the, that's one of my favorite songs of all time, but his version of that song is really lovely. And to hear him introduce someone by saying, I wish I had written that song, it's that good, now here's the guy that wrote it to sing, you know, his own song. And like,
that
that's
was
what
when
I mean
Randy
about,
Newman did Sail Away, when he was introducing Randy Newman.
He sings that I Love You the First Time I Saw You.
I will never forget, I'm drunk now, baby, but I've got to be, or I never could tell you what you mean to me. But I loved you the first time I saw you, and I always will love you.
Really, like, whoa, it's just a killer, that song. I just, the idea that you could have all these people in one place, and you know, for him to bring Randy Newman on, who had never been, obviously the second show, he had never been on the show either. He went on to do 8 musical guest appearances on
somebody
the show
who,
himself.
Yeah, we might have an episode with Randy Newman at some point.
Yeah.
He's synonymous with SNL.
Totally. So anyway, that, you know, we could go on about that first show forever, but I just think it's spectacular kind of approach, and it's a really great show.
Me too. I think this was a great Paul Simon show, or SNL the concert, we'll call it, but not quite an episode of SNL that we're used to. Though Paul was in a sketch on Weekend Update with Connie Hawkins that I really liked too.
I do. I like that sketch too. It's maybe not, it's funny, like it's maybe not the most culturally sensitive sketch now.
It was 1975, I don't know.
But it's really pretty great and pretty funny. And Connie Hawkins is actually quite hilarious in it. And so it's another kind of like template setting thing where, you know, there's a big interaction between SNL and figures from sports throughout the years and putting athletes into the show because they are funny and figuring out that you could do that. And it's just a pretty hilarious segment in terms of how it's cut together.
It's a great sight gag, too, because for the uninitiated, Connie Hawkins was an NBA player, and he was Dr. J.
About 7 feet tall, right?
He's pretty tall. He was basically Dr. J before Dr. J. He was this high-flying basketball player who was really famous in the early to mid-70s. And the conceit of this the sketch in Weekend Update was Paul Simon playing one-on-one with Connie Hawkins. And you can just imagine the sight gag.
Right.
Yeah, Paul Simon, I don't know what's his official listed height, but he's a short man.
Yeah, and also the central conceit is that Hawkins challenged Paul Simon.
Yeah.
Not the other way around, because he's heard that he's one of the best street b-ball players around. And he's like, I want to play the best.
Yeah, and it seems like Paul could actually kind of play.
Oh, yeah,
size.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Seems like he likes to play pickup basketball and stuff. Like, Paul didn't look too awkward out there. But that was when I was a kid. I have very vivid memories of seeing that on like replays on Comedy Central and everything. So that was one of that, probably that sketch with Connie Hawkins was maybe my first intro to Paul Simon as far as his time on SNL. Not necessarily the musical performances. So yeah, nice first episode there for Paul Simon. And I want to couple it with his second appearance, which was November 20th, 1976. That was season 2, episode 8. He was credited as the host again. Musical guest George Harrison, which is important here. And this also produced, I think, some pretty chilling performances. So George Harrison on with Paul Simon. I mean, great match.
Well, it leads to one of the first great callback jokes, which is the fact that, you know, Lorne had gone on the air and offered the Beatles $1,000.
Oh, that was around,
To come and appear on the show. And then when Harrison shows up, he's got to explain to him, well, we thought it was implicit that you would only get 1/4 of that because you're only 1/4 of the Beatles. And so I can only okay a check for you for $250. And Harrison is like, that is not enough money. I flew over here for this. Like, it's a very funny, like the fact that he sort of puts him on the spot. That, to me, that's a great joke. But yeah, the music is obviously great. And, you know, they again, Paul Simon is not precious about whose music he's playing. He seems to trade equally in like, I'll play one of yours, you play one of mine, and we'll figure out these really great. It's still in that era when, you know, he leans toward just guitars and voices. They don't really play with a band as to my recollection of it.
Right.
And like, how can you do better than, you know, that era of George Harrison?
Yeah.
You know, he also put together some very sort of proto early music videos that Eric Idle directed that are on the show of some of the songs that are going to be on his next album. Yeah. But
he didn't get shortchanged.
Are great.
Yeah. No, I was gonna say George Harrison was billed as a musical guest. And even though Paul Simon performed six songs, however you want to count that, Still Crazy After All These Years in a turkey costume. I guess that's a half a song that he performed. But Paul Simon performed that whole episode, but George Harrison didn't get shortchanged. In addition to the songs he performed with Paul Simon, as you mentioned, there were two music videos that aired that. So George Harrison was all over that show as well as Paul Simon.
Again, it's this thing of like, he's just generous. You know, for a show that's about collaboration, I think he really embodies that. He really is interested in the collaborations of it. Also, the turkey sketches, I think it's an all-timer.
It's one of the most memorable monologues in the show's history.
Like, the fact that he is able to keep it together long enough to start playing Still Crazy After All These Years before the audience realizes what's about to happen. Like, he could have lost it. You come out wearing a turkey like that, because it's a great costume. It's really over the top. Yeah. And, you know, and then you have to, like, take this serious moment with your guitar and be like, four in the morning. You know, like, what are you doing, right? It's great. It's just, it's perfect.
So, like, good comedic straight man from Paul Simon right there. The performances, he's terrific. The performances that he did with George Harrison, the first one was Here Comes the Sun, which was a Beatles song that George wrote.
Little darling, the smiles return into the faces. Little darling, it seems like years since it's been here. Here comes the sun, do, do, do. Here comes the sun. Well, it's all right.
I really enjoyed this performance. This song's always been a Beatles favorite of mine, so I thought it was great to see like Paul do one of the parts. You know, he and George actually traded singing. They harmonized together, but then they each did a part of the song on their own. That was really fantastic. And then Homeward Bound was another one. So you were right, like they traded songs. So the Here Comes the Sun, they did a George song, and then they did Homeward Bound.
Tonight I'll sing my songs again, I'll play the game and pretend. Mm-hmm. But all my words come back to me in shades of mediocrity. Like emptiness in harmony, I need someone to comfort me. I wish I was homebound. Home, where my thoughts escaping. Home, where my music's playing. Home, where my love lies waiting silently for me.
Another really good performance. This is just like the music geek side of me is just in heaven with these performances. He also did 50 Ways to Leave Your Lover. Not a favorite of mine as far as he goes, but it's a Paul Simon classic.
At the risk of being crude, there must be 50 ways to leave your lover. 50 ways to leave your lover. You just slip out the back, Jack. Make a new plan, Stan. Don't need to be coy, Roy. Just listen to me. Hop on the bus, Gus. No need to discuss much, just drop off the key and get yourself free.
50 Ways was the single, and I think he did it because he was promoting that album. And
okay.
You kind of have to sing the single.
Yeah.
But I also think it's, we'll come back to it because it has been performed a second time quite effectively. So we can talk about kind of like just whether... You know, maybe I'll change your mind on 50 Ways. I think it's a better song.
No, I don't think it's a bad song. But as far as on the hierarchy, it's just sort of always been kind of there for me. I appreciate it. One of my favorite songs of all time, though, he performed as well as Bridge Over Troubled Water.
Friends just can't be found like a bridge over. I will lay me down like a bridge over troubled water. I will lay me down.
That would probably be, I mean, I have a Spotify playlist of like my top 25 to 30 favorite songs ever, and Bridge Over Troubled Water is on that playlist. That's how much I hold it in high regard. And this closed the show. And I don't think an A-plus performance of the song, but it was good to hear it. And I think he did a good job. And you mentioned there was two songs that he performed twice on the show. One was The Boxer, and Bridge Over Troubled Water was the other one.
And also I was reading something just offline, just reading about Simon himself, talking about his songwriting. And he actually said that he likes all his songs, but that he actually... When he finished writing Bridge Over Troubled Water, he remembers thinking to himself, oh, I think I might have exceeded myself there. That might be better than me.
I stumbled on something that I can't replicate necessarily.
Yeah, yeah. That might be above my pay grade, that song. It is pretty perfect.
Yeah. That's almost scary. It's like I did such a good job that I set the expectations too high. That would be like a fear, like a George Costanza. That would be like an existential crisis from him.
That's right.
Like I can't replicate this. Yeah, I could see that. That's really funny. He performed six songs, and he was billed as the host. And he performs six songs throughout the night. That's not a complaint. It's just very different SNL, much like the first episode.
Right. He sort of gradually eases himself into sketches over the years. Because you can see it's not like his most comfortable thing. But he does get better and better at them as the years go by in terms of just being comfortable on stage doing just a regular sketch. So I understand why he would have leaned towards music at this point, because he's still kind of finding his feet as a... you know, as a comedic person.
Yeah, the show is too. The show is still finding its feet as well.
Yeah. But it's a, you know, again, it's a great show. And it's sort of almost exactly a year after he had first appeared. And I mean, I think that's the other thing is, you know, you talk about this friendship with Lorne and him. I think as the years went by, it was something where he knew he could pretty much call him anytime, but you get the sense that he's trying not to wear it out.
Yeah.
He's trying not to use him. Actually, he uses him a ton, but it's still, he could have, especially in that first year, he could have been back that first year. I think easily could have been back if they needed the ratings boost. Cause he really was like a special performer. And I think a lot of people would have tuned in just to see him. And to their credit, they waited until the next season. Right.
Yeah.
Or really till really like the middle of season two to bring him back.
Yeah. He came back in season three, like kind of at the beginning of season three.
Well, this I want to talk about because the show he came back for in season three, which again, as far as sort of there's quite a few times that they've done these sort of like experiment shows. And this one is one of my favorites is Charles Grodin doing this experiment where he doesn't know it's live and he's not prepared and he keeps interrupting the sketches, which is like a really great conceit and very Charles Grodin, like right in line with his personality. You could just see him being the author of that. Like, what if I was a jerk about this the whole time? And they're like, that is great. Let's do that. So
Charles Grodin's like king of the dry humor, like the driest of the dry. He does that perfectly.
He keeps interrupting sketches going like, this is just not working for me. I don't understand what you're doing. That is show number 50. And I think that that's the significance. I think they brought him back for show number 50 because the next time he was on, it was show number 100.
Oh, wow.
So my suspicion is that they thought that maybe they would have him come every 50 shows. And then it will, you know, and unfortunately, after show 100 was shortly before Lorne was fired. So it's probably why he's not on show 150. And they sort of figured like, oh, we can't do it. But like he was on show 50 and then he was on show 100.
Yeah, he wasn't on any shows in the Gene Dumanian, Dick Ebersol era. So, of course, I mean, he showed loyalty to Lorne. Not like Lorne. I think Lorne would have been fine if Paul wanted to go on, especially because Lorne and Dick Ebersol were friends. But Paul Simon, I mean, that was a coincidence that he...
It also coincides... Yeah, it also coincides with his marriage to Carrie Fisher and a pretty messy divorce and a kind of a... You know, it's when he wrote Hearts and Bones, which I would call... That is the most depressed Paul Simon album of all times. It's a great album, but boy, it's like that and Shoot Out the Lights are like, these are the theme song albums of divorce.
This is like Paul Simon's really, emo period.
Yeah, totally, right? So like, I can completely understand that he would have been like, I don't really feel like being funny right now.
Yeah, I'm depressed. I need to listen to The Cure and then this Paul Simon album. just to wallow. Yeah. So there was something from that Charles Grodin episode too. It was kind of funny that another appearance by Art Garfunkel, they performed, well, Paul and Charles Grodin performed The Sound of Silence.
Hello, darkness, my old friend. I come to talk with you again. Because a vision softly creeping left its seeds while I was sleeping, and the vision that was planted in my brain.
Charles Grodin was dressed as Art Garfunkel, and then maybe one of the earliest instances of this that I could remember on SNL were the person being impersonated does the walk-on.
Listen, Art, I didn't know you were here. I wish I would never
have done. What are you doing?
You see, I had a film clip in the show, and it was cut way down. I never would have done this if
Chuck, hand it over.
I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I'm really sorry, everyone. Yes. I'm sorry.
Thanks, Chuck.
It's the second greatest Simon and Garfunkel joke in the history of the show. There is an even better one coming up later on, but it is certainly a good one, which is just that he, after Simon leaves, he's like, I can't do this. This is stupid. Uh-huh. And he leaves. And then Charles Grodin decides he's going to go solo and sing some Art Garfunkel songs on his own. And then finally Art Garfunkel comes out and goes like, just get out of here. Give me that wig.
Yeah. Right?
Which is great. Which is a definitely. Great joke.
Like a precursor to De Niro and Pesci walking off and Jennifer Aniston and all that. Yeah.
So then he did episode 100, which is, some people call this the episode without a host, although technically he and James Taylor are the co-hosts of the show. It's a weird show. It's a weird show because they do a couple of songs, but it's actually, they're not actually, to my recollection, they're not actually in it very much.
No.
It's kind of like an all over the place show, which is why I think people don't think it has a host. It is a cool pairing to see him with James Taylor. That is not a pairing that I would have sort of thought up. And they do obviously share a musical sensibility, but like it's fun to see them play off of each other and you realize, oh, that could have gone somewhere. Like, again, he collaborates. He doesn't just come on himself virtually ever. So the next show is the one that I remember watching live, which is where he opens the show with his backing band singing You Can Call Me Al. And then Ladysmith Black Mambazo comes out to do Homeless with him, I think, is their song. And he was the host, and that was in the Robert Downey Jr., Randy Quaid era of the show, where Lorne had just come back and had decided that because everybody got addicted to drugs the last time, they were going to have separate performers and separate writers, and those two were not going to mix.
Yeah.
And that lasted one season. And the
you
only
just said Randy Quaid era of the show. That's pretty bleak.
It is pretty bleak. I mean, really, really, it's the John Lovitz.
No, right.
season. But yeah, and I think it's the one that has the sketch where he and John Lovitz are in prison, which is actually a very funny sketch, mostly because physically he's really funny in it.
Mm-hmm.
But I remember it because, like I said, I had gone absolutely ape for Graceland. I thought it was like a really incredible album. I was super in love with it. And he came out and, you know, and that show was in May. And then I saw that tour that summer at Maple Leaf Gardens in Toronto.
Oh, really?
With all of those same people. So Ladysmith Black Mambazo, Hugh Masekela was on that tour. The same band that he had put together from the townships. And like, I was in the tank for that. So it was obviously a show that I was going to watch live. And I remember really just loving it and getting to revisit it now was such a treat, I think. And he opens the show. It's a cold open on music, which they rarely, if ever, like never do really, but works really effectively.
If you would be my bodyguard, I can be your long lost pal. Yeah, I can call you Betty. Betty, when you call me, you can call me out.
It also shows you just what a juggernaut that album was.
Yeah.
Because that first episode in 1986, I think that album was just released. And, you know, then he came back in November of 1986, which is technically the next season, season 12, does more songs from the album. And then he came back in season 13 in 1987, did more songs from that album because it was still going.
Yeah.
You know, and that brought on Linda Ronstadt and an entire mariachi band. And did even more stuff from Graceland, like, you know, and she was also a collaborator on Graceland. And so this thing of collaboration, bringing on these diverse musical styles, bringing on, and that is a show that I think is special just because Linda Ronstadt has had a really rough few years and she was so magnificent. And it's kind of this wistful thing of like, look at what a brilliant human being this was. And, you know, just physically one of the most beautiful women, I think, in my lifetime. But also, like, the voice is incredibly good. And to think that she can't sing anymore, and, like, it's really it's a little heartbreaking to watch it now. I get chills watching her. So yeah.
Yeah. And it's interesting to me, those first two or three appearances after he released Graceland, he didn't actually perform the song Graceland until May 15th, 1993, when he was billed as a co-musical guest with Willie Nelson.
As if I'd never noticed the way she brushed her hair from her forehead. She said, you sang love like a window in your heart. Everybody sees you're blown apart. Everybody feels the wind blow. I'm going to Graceland. In Memphis, Tennessee, I'm going to Graceland.
That was the first song that they performed, was Graceland with Willie Nelson.
And he lets Willie take the vocal.
Yeah, that was one of the main notes that I wrote.
And that's, again, a really interesting flavor to bring to that song, which obviously has a lot to do with Memphis and and country music, but isn't really a country music song.
Yeah.
But hearing Willie Nelson's voice on it, it changes it, right? It's really,
yeah, exactly. Yeah. That's one of the ones that I definitely highlighted in all of these Paul Simon appearances. Was this Graceland performance with Willie Nelson. So we can kind of just kind of bump around and talk about the highlights. Anything else that stood out to you with Paul Simon and his appearances on SNL?
Well, then he did this sort of semi-sequel to Graceland, which was The Obvious Child, which was, I can't remember the name of the album now, but the follow-up album, instead of taking African rhythms, he decided, I'm going to take Brazilian drums and rhythms. And he brings this, again, killer band, unbelievably killer Brazilian drum corps on with him. And the performances are remarkable because they're never about him. It's always about highlighting the people that are playing with him. And that show that he did where Dennis Hopper hosted, where he does The Obvious Child and Proof, and then he decides, well, maybe I'll come back with Willie Nelson and do that. And then in between that show with Dennis Hopper and the show where Kevin Kline hosted and he brought Willie Nelson, there's a very important non-appearance by him, which was a show in 1992 where Edie Brickell and the New Bohemians had their first appearance on the show. And he was visiting the show that day. And if you watch Edie Brickell's performance, you can actually see the moment where she first sees Paul Simon.
Really?
and falls in love with him. Yeah.
Wow. Wow. Yeah. They got married pretty shortly after that. It was a quick romance between he and Edie Brickell. Yeah. They're still married.
So they are still married. They have three kids. And so she saw him because he was standing beside the cameras, just hanging out with Lorne.
Wow.
While the show was going, he wasn't on the show, but she saw him, and you can see that she sort of loses her place in the song for about a half a second. And it's because she has essentially fallen in love with this guy. Yeah.
I'm going to go back and watch that. I urge our listeners to go back, find the SNL episode. We believe it was 92.
I think so.
Yeah. Around then, find the first time Edie Brickell appeared, watch her musical performances, and try to find where she spots Paul Simon and essentially starts a 30 plus year marriage.
So then when he came back, when Dana Carvey was the host, he was not a billed musical guest, but he plays with her because she plays. And
he was only on guitar. It was for the song Green.
And he wasn't billed, and it wasn't like a big deal. Right. He was just part of her band. Right. And you just know that it's him, but like they make no mention of it. It's just kind of nice.
Yeah. Right? He's just right there.
And then, he doesn't come back again until the year 2000. So quite a lot of time goes by and quite a lot of, he didn't put out a lot of music in kind of the late 90s. And then he came back with this album, which I actually think is his best album.
Really? And it was released in 2000. Okay.
Yeah.
I think the tendency with a lot of these legacy artists is people tend to tune out after a certain point, but we always will be surprised, and we shouldn't be shocked, but a lot of times we are, that some of their best work happens more under the radar. And this probably qualifies.
Yeah, this album and So Beautiful or So What are both like among my favorites. And this one especially is a favorite of mine because it talks about having kids. And it talks about having kids at the same time that I had a kid. So the album came out in 2000 and my son was born earlier that year. And it talks about the idea of going with your kids to taking them to school and what it's like. And it's got a different sound from anything he had done before. It has a really crazy rhythmic guitar, and he started to bring banjo into it, but not in a way that sounds like traditional kind of banjo. Like, he actually came up with a new sound for banjo. So when he's on that show, it also solidifies, like, the band that's on the show with him in 2000 was his band right until the end. He pretty much had all the same players around him for the rest of the time that he toured. In 2018, he announced that he was no longer going to tour. But from 2000 to 2018, he had this same sort of core group. And that's the first time that I saw them perform together was on that show. He did two songs. I think they're both, like, their favorite songs of mine from that album, Hurricane Eye and Old. Old especially is a really funny song.
The human race has walked the earth for 2.7 million. And we estimate the universe about 13, 14 billion. When all these numbers tumble into your imagination, consider that the Lord was there before creation. God is old. We're not old. God is old. He made them old.
And just a really great idea for a song. Like, the lyrics of it are among my favorite Paul Simon lyrics. It's really a fun song.
That's awesome. I'm going to have to go listen to that album. If you hold it in high regard.
I do very much. That's really great.
And so his next appearance is maybe one of his most famous. It's one of the most famous, I think, musical performances in SNL history, which was the first episode after 9/11. So that was season 27, episode 1. He was not billed as a musical guest. That was Alicia Keys. But Paul did the de facto cold open, which was a performance of The Boxer.
So a couple things. I think you could argue, rightly or wrongly, I think you could argue it is the most important episode in the history of the show. Mm-hmm. Certainly to people in the United States and in New York City specifically. It is weird to watch it now because Rudy Giuliani is respectable.
But at that time, he kind of was.
And you know what happened later, but you kind of have to realize that certainly at the time he was, you know, he had not gone completely off the deep end.
At that time in 2001, when I saw him on TV, my instant reaction wasn't to go, ugh.
As
it is now. Yeah. So really, Rudy Giuliani opened the show basically and gave sort of a couple of minutes talk and to the United States. He was the mayor of New York at the time. And so he talked at the beginning, and then Paul Simon played the boxer, and then Rudy Giuliani and Lorne Michaels do their little bit, like, oh, are we allowed to be funny? And then Rudy Giuliani says, why start now?
Why start now? It's a great line.
It's a really good line.
I'm almost sure it's a, now I can't remember his name. Who's the writer? That's the
Jim Downey.
Jim Downey. Yeah. It sounds like a Jim Downey line, doesn't it?
Yeah.
A couple things about that show that I think bear mentioning. One is that in no universe would I have considered The Boxer to be the obvious choice. When you're going to do a song that is supposed to be, for lack of a better word, patriotic, or certainly pro-America, that is a messy song about what America is really like. That is a song about poverty. That is a song about poverty and prostitutes and body blows and picking yourself up and being a weathered and beaten down person that still has their innate dignity intact. Wow. And boy, when you think about 3 weeks after 9/11, to me, that is miraculous that is the song that he chose to sing, that is the message that he wanted to give, because there was not a lot of subtlety going on in American media in September of 2001.
It was patriotic, very jingoistic, very much so.
Right. And The Boxer is elegiac, and it is about loss, and it is about life not working out in a way and still being worth living. And just that, I think it's chilling to think that he somehow arrived at that. I think that is a mark of genius to be
He could have gone the easy route and done America.
Right.
He has. They have a song. Right? He and Simon. He and Garfunkel have America that he could have just brought out.
He could have sung "Feeling Groovy."
Yeah, right. A little upbeat ditty.
Like, let's all have fun, right? Yeah, he could have absolutely. Like it's quite amazing to see. So that is a huge highlight for me.
I think the aesthetic of that performance really fit the mood of the country at the time.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, going back, some of our younger listeners who don't even really have vivid memories of 9/11, there was a sense in the country of not really wanting to laugh or anything like that. And I think the aesthetic of this song kind of fit that mood. And then, of course, we see in this episode and in the following episode when Sean William Scott hosted that we gradually got into like more goofy sketches and people really wanting to laugh more. But I mean, the mood at the time, and even I'm not like a real patriotic person, like go America, go. But at the time, it was hard not to feel that way after what had just happened 18 days before this performance.
Just contrast it with all of the traps that people fell into in that Concert for New York City thing. Do you remember that like TV special? It is laborious to watch now. It is hard to watch because it is so earnest. It really has no sense of purpose other than to rah-rah America in the most somber tones possible. And it's so it's almost unwatchable now.
Yeah. And in context, and, I mean, that's how most people felt right after 9/11.
Totally.
I mean,
totally. There were two responses to 9/11 that live in my heart forever. One was this episode of SNL and the other was the front page of The Onion, which was put together, I think like 3 days after the tragedy, that led with a giant headline that said, "Angry God clarifies don't kill rule," which is my favorite, like just the balls of putting that together while it's fresh. Uh-huh. That is fucking amazing.
Yeah. And just a perfect concise Onion.
Yeah.
Headline right there. Yeah. That's that's perfect.
Yeah. So those are the two that like I felt like, oh, they figured it out like faster than anyone could really figure it out. Because I don't know if you remember, but The Daily Show came back and Jon Stewart just cried on air. And
I do remember that.
And like it was not appropriate. Like it was not good what he did. Right. And like there are ways to do it. There are ways to honor it without allowing it to, you know, mess you up or change you in a way that's not appropriate, right?
Yeah.
So to me, that's really like a brilliant thing.
Yeah. So this performance of the boxer right after 9/11 goes down in SNL history as one of the more memorable performances in the show's history. So before we go, is there anything else that we should know about?
Two more things I want to quickly mention. One is go back and watch the 40th anniversary show for two things. First of all, he comes out at the beginning, does a really funny joke with Paul McCartney, where they kind of talk about whether the show should be about them. They get kicked off the stage. So that's kind of great. So the first thing is he performs his own song and it closes the show. But Miley Cyrus did 50 Ways to Leave Your Lover. And it's great. And if you don't think that song is great, seek out that version of it. It's great. It's super good.
Yeah. I'll revisit it.
Yeah. So he's all over that show almost twice because he not only gets his own material, but then somebody else does his material as part of their, you know, performance. But the last thing I want to mention is that the very last time he performed on the show when Seth Meyers was the host, which was in 2018, was also the very last time that he performed publicly.
Was it? I had no idea about that. Okay.
He had just finished his tour and he had announced that he was retiring from touring. And true to form, it is not a performance of his own. It is a performance of Y Music, of his music, where he simply sings vocals. So they do Can't Run But and Bridge Over Troubled Water. I'm sailing right behind, like a bridge over troubled water. I will ease your mind. Both these spectacular classical sextet arrangements, and Can't Run But especially is almost like a Philip Glass avant-garde kind of piece. But the two performances together are great. And you can also hear in Bridge Over Troubled Water that his voice is finally starting to leave him in the upper registers. He cannot quite get it over. And it's remarkable, like from a, just a human standpoint of, you know, as someone ages and you just kind of accept the changes of life, and to see, you know, I want to thank you for the treat of getting to like view this guy's career over 45 years and see these small changes in him and what he brought to the show. And like right to the end, he was bringing other people along with him and showing them and their talent. And if that's not a kind of a statement about what the show should be about, then I don't know really what is. I know that I think no musical guests have ever gotten into the hall, but if there's any justice in the world, he ought to be the first. I just, you know, that is a remarkable run, and he is as deserving as anyone in terms of his contributions to the lifetime of SNL.
So there's that. That's Matty Price and Thomas Senna in conversation about Paul Simon. Could he be the first musical guest elected to the Hall of Fame? I don't know. I'm baffled. Will he be the number that Dave Grohl put up last time? Dave Grohl put up 30-something%. And that's the highest that a musical guest has got so far. And that's in Grohl's first ballot. Will Paul Simon in his first ballot achieve a higher score than that? Will he make the Hall of Fame? I don't know. But does he deserve to be in the Hall of Fame? Absolutely. There's no doubt in my mind that he is a Hall of Famer. And whether or not he makes it in the first ballot, we shall see. But this is a man that has been, you know, a friend of the show since episode 2. And that's a nice run. That's a real nice run. So there's that. Let's listen to the nomination sketch or song. In this case, it's a song. This is Paul Simon doing The Boxer, and this comes on the first episode after 9/11. I believe it was Reese Witherspoon hosting, and they did a cold open with a choir, and I believe they did a cold open with the choir, and then Paul Simon came out? Or no, they just had all the firefighters there. That's what it was. There wasn't a choir. It was all the firefighters and policemen standing. Gosh, I don't. Send me an email, jamie@snlhof.com, reminding me of the first episode back from 9/11. It was Reese Witherspoon, right? And she told a joke, like a straight up joke. Anyway, this is The Boxer from that episode. And it's tremendous. So let's get to it now.
I'm just a poor boy, though my story is seldom told. I squandered my resistance for a pocket full of mumbles, such are promises. All lies and jests, still a man hears what he wants to hear and disregards the rest. When I left my home and my family, I was no more than a boy in the company of strangers, in the quiet of the railway station, running scared, laying low, seeking out the poor quarters where the ragged people go, looking for the places only they would know. Lie, la, lie, lie. Asking only workmen's wages, I come looking for a job, but I get no offers. Just a
come on from the whores on 7th Avenue. I do declare there were times when I was so lonesome I took some comfort there. La 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 la. Wishing I was gone, going home, where the New York City winters aren't bleeding me, leading me, going home. In the clearing stands a boxer and a fighter by his trade, and he carries the reminders of every glove that laid him down or cut him till he cried out in his anger and his shame. Well, I'm leaving, but the fighter still remains, he still remains.
I wasn't lying when I said that was tremendous, was I? Yeah, that's just a barn burner. And that's just one of many, many appearances that Mr. Simon has made on the show. So consider that as you're casting your votes when the time comes, and we will be announcing that very soon. Consider that. Think about that. Think about the musical guest's performance in the show. It's quite important. The show would be a different show without it. So there's that. I hope you had a good week. I have had a fantastic week. It's always good to touch base with you, and I'm glad we got this opportunity to do that. So on behalf of Thomas Senna and Matt Ardill, I want to thank Matti Price, and I want to thank all the listeners for joining us each and every week. Make sure to register to vote. That's what I've got for you this week. Be cool. And if you do me a favor on your way out, as you pass the Weekend Update exhibit, turn out the lights, because the SNL Hall of Fame is now closed.
Thanks for listening to the SNL Hall of Fame podcast. Make sure to rate, review, share, and subscribe to the show wherever you get your podcasts. Follow us on social media at SNLHOF. This is Doug Denant saying, see you next week.
Duvra. Podcasts and such. When you love someone, seeing them struggle with their mental health can be one of the hardest things in the world, especially when you know they need help, but don't know where to turn. That's why 988 Lifeline is here. 988's trained crisis counselors are available 24/7 by phone or text to provide you with the resources and support you need to help the people you love. No one should have to struggle alone. Call or text 988 Suicide and Crisis Lifeline day or night. 988. Hope has a new number.